May the Lord bring your mind, heart, and lips to worthy proclaim his holy gospel, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. One does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes forth from the mouth of God. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When Jesus heard of the death of John the Baptist, he withdrew in a boat to a deserted place by himself. The crowds heard of this and followed him on foot from their towns. When he disembarked and saw the vast crowd, his heart was moved with pity for them, and he cured their sick. And when it was evening, the disciples approached him and said, "This is a deserted place, and it is already late. Dismiss the crowds so that they can go to the villages and buy food for themselves." And Jesus said to them, "There is no need for them to go away. Give them some food yourselves." But they said to him, "Five loaves and two fish are all we have." Then he said, "Bring them here to me." And he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the five loaves and two fish and looking up to heaven, he said the blessing, broke the loaves, and gave them to the disciples, who in turn gave them to the crowds. They all ate and were satisfied. And they picked up the fragments left over in 12 wicker baskets full. Those who ate were about 5,000, not counting women and children. The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. When I was a kid, I remember going to a clam bake, and it was amazing because we just walked in and we were fed all day long. There were the hot dogs and the hamburgers, and there was chicken, and there was clams on a half shell. And of course, there was the keg of root beer and other things around. But no matter when you went, there was always food. Even when people were leaving, there was still food on the grill. There was a little root beer left. I think there was another keg that was quite empty. And basically, I thought, look at all this food. We couldn't move. We could hardly move. Then, of course, I remember going to a wedding before I was ordained a priest, over in Westchester. And it was a two-hour cocktail hour. Abandon hope, all ye who went to hear. And we went to this, and we kept eating. And they had the buffet stations and all the stuff. And every time you went back, it looked like no one had touched it because it kept replenishing. Nothing ran out. And after 2 hours, I remember looking, and it looked almost brand new, like no one had really eaten because it kept replenishing magically over the course of the 2 hours. I remember going my first time to an Italian home for dinner on Sunday afternoon. I come from an Irish background. Antipastos were put out, delightful. And we sat down to lasagna. And I thought, well, that's the dinner. Have another piece of lasagna. No, I'm okay. You don't like it. I'll have another piece of lasagna. Well, then came the roast beef with the vegetables and all the things that go with it. And finally, mercifully, I thought, they're only putting fruit on the table for dessert. Wrong. That was the prelude to the Viennese table. And we're saying, like, in the end, they said, how come you had so much food? The lady said, because where I come from, you never run out of anything. If you even want another olive, and I don't have that olive, I'm disgraced. I said, okay. But it was amazing how it was fed in abundance. Imagine the people of Jesus' time. They're excited. Jesus is here. They stop their work. They stop what they're doing and they pursue him. They don't know how far he's going. They don't know they're going to be hungry at the end of the day. All of a sudden, they're out there in the middle of nowhere, and they're really hungry. And Jesus has compassion on them. He can do anything he wants. He has the power of God at his disposal. He allows some loaves of bread and some fish to be passed around and passed around and passed around. And by the time they all eat their fill, they gather up 12 baskets of leftovers. I mean, they couldn't eat everything that he had provided. They couldn't consume all the bounty of what he had given to them in the middle of nowhere. So Jesus shows compassion, and he shows that he doesn't just dole it out. Jesus feeds us in abundance. He overdoes it. God is beyond our imagination with his generosity to you and to me. But of course, what were they there for? They were there for more than just a meal. They were there because ultimately Jesus is the bread of life. He's the bread that came down from heaven. Jesus feeds them in a way that is beyond their expectations. Imagine God is in their presence. Imagine that if you just thought about it, to feel God himself is in your presence, and that his words are the words of eternal life. What he gives to them in his gospel, what he provides for them in his words, what he allows them to experience in his presence is worth more than anything they could possibly imagine. So God could have made things right again through the law and the prophets. There were many good men that came and really proclaimed the word of God. But God was more generous than that. Not just holy men, not just some prophets, not just some very special leaders. God sends to us his son. He gives to us his son, who is the word made flesh, who dwelt among us. And he personally gives to us the words of eternal life. And so today we see how good and generous God is to each and every one of us. There's nothing we can do to earn heaven. There's nothing we can do to say to God, now I deserve something. What could we ever do in the course of a human life to merit all eternity, to have God provide for us for all time, to allow us to enjoy eternal happiness forever and ever, ages upon ages? And that's the generosity of God. We would probably never treat each other that generously. At a certain point, we kind of draw the line and say, well, you know, that's about as much as I can give. That's all. I have to save some for myself. I have to provide for my future, but I'll help you. God doesn't measure anything. He gives to us his son. His son gives to us his life on the cross. God says, you know what? One day I will raise you from the dead too because of my love, not because I owe you, but because I love you. So God provides for the people loaves and fishes, which last them for a day. The next day we'll find out they're looking for him again because their stomachs are hungry. But if they really listen to him and consume his words of life and put those words into practice in their daily lives, they will not be spiritually hungry. They will not be spiritually starving anymore. They will be filled and filled to abundance. So you and I tonight can thank God for the gift of our faith and the gift of Jesus, his son, because he's the one who takes care of us always. When we sin, he forgives us. When we pray to him, he listens. When we're spiritually hungry, he feeds us with the bread of life at this table. And at our moments of need, when we utter our last breath, he's there to provide nothing less than resurrection and eternal life. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen.